Hi, I'm Alex Tadashev, and today I wanted to talk about using the secure firewall on a control network. So when I say control network, I mean a process control network, like maybe a chemical plant, a water treatment plant, of course, power distribution, power plant, power companies. So we usually call this OT, operational technology, or we've also called this SCADA or SCADA. So that stands for supervisory control and data acquisition. So that's typically what we've called those networks in the past. So these networks are things that control the physical world, right? So things that control processes, again, plants, power, big one is power, right? So there are special considerations and special things you can do with the firewall on a network like this, because this is not a typical network. It's not like your typical corporate network where you have internet apps and internet traffic and malware coming in and going out and users clicking on things. You don't have that kind of traffic on a control network, so it's a lot different. So some of the things different about this type of network. So first of all, it's static, right? So there aren't as many changes. There aren't as many things going on. You're not adding or moving machines all the time. You don't have DHCP addresses coming and going all the time. Users, guest users on guest wireless. None of that stuff happens on a control network. It's a lot more control, a lot more static. So once things are set up and work, they just work. And the adage we usually follow there is, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? So, which also goes back to why control networks are typically not as up to date. Now that's changed a lot in recent years, but back when I was doing this with a power company, you know, a number of years ago, too many to count, honestly, those systems were never patched. They were never updated. I mean, if they work, we just don't change them. They're totally cut off from the internet. Again, this is a few years ago, so we don't change them. And that's still a lot of the mindset there, and I can understand why. If you've ever set up an OT network yourself, like even my sprinklers at home, right? Once they work with my little Raspberry Pi, I don't want to change it, right? If I update it, great, I have the latest Raspberry Pi now, but I might just break something in the app, right? So I'm more likely just to leave that alone, let it work. If it works, don't break, no, fix it, right? So that's another thing about those networks. They're not as up to date usually. They're not patched every day or every week or every time a new patch comes out. And again, because it's the uptime, it's availability is what is important there. They have to be up, they have to work. So these things, these power distribution especially, it just won't work without the control network. And you can't manually go and be flipping all those relays and switches and balancing power and make it work. You have to have that technology working. So another thing that, because of the difference I noted, the rule set you're going to use on the firewall is not the same, right? So you're not going to grab the balanced rule set from Talos, which I would recommend you use on a regular, you know, corporate network or a business network. You're not going to grab that balanced rule set, throw it out in your control network and think you've got it covered, because you don't, right? Because you just don't have the same traffic out there. You may catch a couple things here and there, maybe, but there are rules in that rule set we need to look at, and I'll show you in a bit here, that you need to consider for that control network. There are also other things you can do, leverage in the system, and I'll go over a couple recommendations there too that will help you understand changes to that network, right? Because again, it's a static network, things don't change very often. So there are other aspects, correlation rules, correlation policies, which I'll go over, which can help you understand if something is changing that maybe it shouldn't be. Because this can be a good indication that something's up, right? Someone's plugged something in they shouldn't have, someone's on the network that shouldn't be there. So these are the things that you're going to want to look for, you can look for with a secure firewall, the very minute changes that you just can't look for on a more dynamic network, right? So you can do that with this. So those are some of the, it's just a quick overview. Again, there's a lot more considerations in this, obviously, but I'm just trying to get you guys started here, give a kind of an overview of my view anyway of what a SCADA or OT network might look like when it's protected with a secure firewall. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump in the FMC. I'm just going to show you a few things with the intrusion policy, some considerations you might think of, some things on correlation, and then I'm not showing you everything you can do, but just some thoughts on what you might want to do on a controlled network to leverage some of the features of the secure firewall. Okay, so here we are on the secure firewall. We're looking at the dashboard, just kind of a landing page. What I want to go over, again, a couple things. I'm just going to go over some nuances or changes you might want to look at on the intrusion policy rule set, And then we'll take a look at correlation rules. So I think that's a really powerful feature for a network, like a control network like this. So first of all, let's look at intrusion policy. And I'm going to look at SNORT 3 since it's the newest thing. But this same kind of guidance applies to SNORT 2 as well. So things you might think about. So I'm going to go over to policies, intrusion. There's a bunch of policies here already. Let's just create one real quick for a control network. Let's call it SCADA. And we'll put a prevention mode. I'm going to go ahead and go with no rules active here. What we're going to have here is a completely customized rule set. Okay, we've got our new SCADA policy here, so I'm going to go edit that, the SNORT 3 version. So in the SNORT 3 version, this is the SNORT 3 policy editor, gone over it before. The only difference here is we don't have any rules enabled. Typically, we'll have a rule set already. You can see up on the right, the active rules are zero. So let's go to the group overrides. Let's take a look at the rule groups. So down in the rule categories, then we find all the rule groups for specific things like different browsers and operating systems and things like that. Down in the protocol category, we have rule groups for protocols, and one of those is SCADA. So supervisory control and data acquisition, as we mentioned. So this gives you the look at the groups. Now there's nothing in here, there's no security level. So let's go to the overrides. We'll look at those rules in the rule overrides. So now in the specific rule overrides, you can make a change to the rule state, which is what we want to do. And we're looking at just again that rule category protocol and the group SCADA. Now there are only 605 rules here in this group. You notice they're all disabled right now. So you could conceivably just enable all those and still have a pretty small rule set. But there, a lot of these are written for specific vendor specific products. So you know, if you go through here, you can search for those. Now, you know what products you have. You know what vendors you're using on your control network. So what you can do is you can go in here and search for that. So if you know you have Schneider Controls, for instance, S-C-H-N-E-I-D-E-R, we'll search for that. So you can see there's 13 rules here for a Schneider control system, Schneider Electric, right? So let's say that you knew you had this in this particular system, then you can enable these rules. You may want to only enable the rules for the specific system you have too. So there may be other, you know, products within a vendor's space that you have, and you don't want to enable every rule for every product because you don't have specific ones. And these are written, again, a lot of these, most of these for a particular vendor, are written for specific issues or vulnerabilities with that software. So that's what the SNORT rules are for. So you can go in here, click that rule action. You can set that to alert or block, whatever you want. Again, other vendors, so if you had someone for Advantech. So again, there's 10 rules there. So maybe you know you have this product as well. You can enable those. So the point here is find the rules that you have in your for your vendors, enable those. You don't need all the vendors here, right? You just need the ones that you have. And again, being a static system, a smaller network, you probably have a lot better idea, right? I know you do, of what's there rather than what's on the whole corporate network, right? That's like the Wild West compared to a control network. Now, something else you probably want to look for here is the protocols. Now, again, Modbus being a very common one, you'll find Modbus rules in the SCADA group. Now, some of these are specific, right? We've enabled a couple of these already because they had Modbus in them for Schneider here. But some of these are just generic Modbus rules, right? So these are written to look for what I call anomalies within the Modbus protocol, right? So somebody scanning functions, somebody sending invalid, you know, type of commands, encapsulating them invalid. So a lot of rules for that. Again, not a ton. How many rules do we have here? 55 rules here for, plus the block one. So 59 total rules here for the SCADA Modbus protocol. So this is, if you use Modbus, sure, enable these. Now, do you want to set these to drop initially? Be really careful, right? Obviously, if we're talking uptime here is critical. So we're going to want to set these to something. Let's do this. We'll uncheck the ones we've already checked. I could have done it with search, but I think there's only four there anyway. And we'll set these to alert. Now, one of the things that I really like to use this for, and what again I use it for at the power company quite a bit, was correlation rules. So if we go over to correlation rules, to go up here to policies and correlation. So a lot of you may not be familiar with those. And again, on a corporate network, they do have value. They're pretty nice, but on a more static network, I think they're even more valuable. So what can you do with these? Well, what you can do, so correlation policy consists of policies and rules. So the policy says what to do when a rule is triggered. The rules, of course, tell you what to look for when they trigger on a particular activity. So if you go over to rule management here, I've written a couple rules to look for events on this network. And again, assuming the network is very static, these things don't change very often. So things like intrusion event just on the control network, or a new host discovered on the control network, or a new TCP listening port on the control network. So before I jump into those last two rules, I want to show you where you can, how I can understand that and where you get that information from. Again, it's an event type that's not terribly well known, I don't think, for most folks. But if we go up to analysis, you'll find under hosts this entry for discovery events. So discovery events are something that are triggered with your discovery policy. So your discovery policy determines what parts of the network, what IP ranges you're going to look at for these changes. And so you've already done that. That's kind of a basic concept. If you don't get that, then look at some of the documentation, look at our README site to get more information on that. But what you'll get is discovery events. And this is an event type, honestly, most people don't know it exists, and hardly nobody looks at it, right? Because this is just normal behavior of a network. But what I want to show you is how some of these events can be used in a more static network, like a control network. So they're pretty generic events. Now I'm looking at the blue events here down about two-thirds of the way down the page. So you have things like new client, new OS, big one there, new host. So a new host is a new host discovered on the network, right? So you have a host database that's been built for all the hosts that we can see with the passive detection on our devices out there. And so we know what IPs we've seen. So as soon as it sees a communication from an IP it hasn't seen before, it generates this new host event. So that means it's a new host I haven't seen before, it just showed up on the network. Again, control network, static network, sure, they add hosts to them from time to time, but rarely, right? You don't add a host every day, every week, every month, probably, to a control network. So when a new host comes on the network, it might be something you might be interested in, because maybe somebody plugged something and they shouldn't have. Maybe the network's connected to something it shouldn't be connected to. Maybe somebody connected a laptop that shouldn't be connected to the network, right? Could be a precursor to an attack. So important events you probably want to know about. If you get a new host, you might want to check your documentation, check your change records, make sure that that new host was expected. Another one you can do is a new listening port. And it's not an event that's on the screen here, but it's a rule I've written in the correlation rule. I'll show you in a second. The point here is, though, you can go through these events, find the events that you think you want to know about, new host being a big one, probably number one, but new OS, new client, new this, new that. So again, once this network settles down, and it only takes a few days of discovery for all these events to kind of slow down to almost nothing on a control network, then they become a lot more significant. So let's go back over to our correlation policies. All right, so again, I said I've written some rules. Let's go back to rule management. Let's look at those rules real quickly. And again, just short, quick examples. You can add more to them. I think these are some of the most critical ones. Let's look at that new host event. So I wrote a rule to look for a new host event. It's pretty straightforward. So I called a new host on the control network. So when you add a correlation rule, you pick the event type. So you have a number of types, right? Intrusion events, discovery, connection, traffic profile changes, malware, etc. So I just picked discovery event. And then when you do that, you pick the event type. These are all the discovery event types. Again, I pick new host, new IP host is detected. Now, I'm assuming that this FMC might be managing other traffic besides just control network traffic. So I limited this to just a specific IP range. I don't have to do this, but if everything this FMC covers is control networks, you might care about it everywhere, right? But you can have an alert for a specific network. So I changed the IP address here. It said IP address is in a certain range, 192.168.10.24. Pretty straightforward. Now, the same thing I did for this other rule is a TCP listening port. Basically, it's the same thing. It's just a different discovery event, right? So I said new TCP listening port, discovery event, open port is detected. And again, what might happen there? Well, maybe somebody installed something, a new service, all of a sudden started listening on this machine. It's like, well, wait a minute, why did it do that? So you might want to look into why there's a new port open on this a server port, basically listening port we're talking about here, that wasn't there before. Again, I limited the IP range. And finally, this is a generic one. You could do this really anywhere. Intrusion event on control network. Now, all this is going to do is going to trigger this correlation rule when there's an intrusion event on a specific IP range. So again, here I picked intrusion event instead of discovery event. And I don't care what the intrusion event is. I could say specific GIDs, generator IDs. I could say specific rule names, whatever. I just said, hey, if I see an intrusion event and the source IP or the destination IP are on my control network, then I want this rule to trigger. So again, I'm concerned about this event. I want it to flow to the top. I want to know about it right away. So it's going to trigger a correlation, or it's going to trigger, the correlation rule is going to trigger on it. Now, these rules by themselves don't do anything. Just like a snort rule, if you wrote a snort rule and didn't deploy it in a policy, it wouldn't do anything. So these rules are ready to be used. Use them over in the correlation policy. So I've written a correlation policy here, created one, pretty straightforward. I call it important events. And in the correlation policy, you can add one or more correlation rules and then a response. Now, without an actual response, the rule will at least trigger a correlation event, separate event type. But the real power of these things is they can do other things, right? So you can trigger a remediation, you can send a syslog, SNMP message, an email message. What I've done here is for all of these events, I've added these rules and I've said, hey, for a response, I want you to email somebody. So at the top one there, I said email the SOC and InfoSec if you see that intrusion event. If you see a new host or a new TCP, email the SOC or wherever. You don't have to email SOC. But point is, you're taking an action in response to one of those events. You're getting a notification that, hey, this popped up. Somebody go look at it. Why is there a new host on the control network? Could be legitimate, might not be. So that's what we're doing with these. So you add the rule. So it works here as you add a rule. So you pick the rules. I've already added them all. They're not there. But then once you add the rule, you use this little balloon here to add the responses. And I've already added all the responses up here. There were two email responses available. I've added those to the for this rule. And I just added one email response to the others. And then once you've created that policy, you just activate it by turning on the little switch here. And then there's no deployment needed, actually. This all happens on the FMC, so you don't have to deploy any changes for this to start working. FMC is what looks at the events coming in and decides what to do. So there's no deployment to the device needed for creating or editing correlation rules or policies. I hope this is helpful to give you some ideas on how to use the Secure Firewall in an OT, operational technology, or a SCADA network. And as always, happy snorting!